Good afternoon. Welcome and thank you all for being here for this very exciting artist talk and live VR painting demonstration. My name is Maria Lopez and I'm the manager of film and lecture programs at the North Carolina Museum of Art. We would like to extend a special thank you to those of you who are members and invite the rest of you to join the museum to begin to enjoy early and discounted access to exhibitions, movies, and concerts, which are coming up this summer. Before we begin with today's event, I'd like to give everyone an overview of the agenda for today. Our guest, Mike Cuales, will be providing some background on VR and introduce our guest artist today, Rhett Hissam. Mike and Rhett will then have a conversation, and then Rhett Hissam will begin her demo. We will then take questions from the audience after the demo. We have this mic set up, so we ask everybody to come in and if you have a question, and come up and ask your question. The whole event should last about an hour and a half, and will also be recorded. Now it is my pleasure to introduce one of our featured guests tonight. Mike Cuales is a creative director and immersive media producer with experience in educational media and innovative technologies. In 2015, he launched LEVR Studios, which has produced 360 VR documentary films, first of its kind science-based VR exhibits, interactive art education experiences, projection-based installations, and public art displays, some which have been featured here at the North Carolina Museum of Art. And Mike has also worked for over 18 years as a creative director at NC State's Delta Distance Education and Learning Technology Applications. Let's give a warm welcome to Mike Cuales.
Thank you. I'm gonna flip a switch or two. This wouldn't be right if I didn't. All right, thank you, Maria. And thank you all for coming out today. Really appreciate your time and for taking the opportunity to talk with us and explore with us today. So we're really happy that you've joined us for this exploration. Kill the ambient music, but that sets the tone correctly. All right, so thank you for that introduction. As Maria said, my name is Mike Cuales, creative director at NC State University's Distance Education Department and the owner of LEVR Studios. And LEVR Studios, I really started as just a passion project, just a way to explore broad use cases for virtual reality. Started about 5 or 6 years ago, and I was so fascinated by this technology. I just started digging in and doing stuff and trying stuff, and it just started ballooning into really, really amazing opportunities from K-12 education engagements, STEM outreach projects, public art installations, corporate training, and as Maria mentioned, some museum-based programs that I'll hopefully share with you today. So, what is immersive technology? I kind of put this definition together after a bit of searching and not being very happy with the definitions that I found online and in talking with other people. It's still really evolving as far as the definition of immersive tech goes. It really spans a broad spectrum. So while virtual reality and augmented reality is not a new concept, our access to these tools and processes and software that surrounds it keeps evolving at an alarming rate. So it feels very new and exciting each time there's an update, each time there's a new invention. And that gives us the opportunity to innovate and develop new processes and new language and even come up with some of our own rules around what the technology is and what it can and or should do, which is a lot of fun. So I want to talk about some examples of how NCMA is embracing immersive tech. And in regard to education, in this case, we used a technology called 360-degree video or interactive 360-degree video to develop a virtual tour of the conservation lab, which allowed rural students and remote learners to explore an area of the museum that is actually kind of off limits to even local visitors for the most part. Then the experience was brought out to these remote communities in with VR headsets, and students could experience this location firsthand. And while 360 video tour could provide an alternative to an in-person visit, My colleague, Derek Allen Rowe, and I were able to leverage this medium as a way to complement or expand traditional exhibits. In this case, we produced a short educational VR video that was presented during the Ansel Adams special exhibit. And through the use of VR, visitors were able to stand in some of the locations that Ansel Adams may have photographed while learning about his method, approach, and decision-making process in photography. So really that transformative or transporting a component of VR was very powerful for that particular exhibit. And as we explored and dug deeper into these emerging mediums, we quickly gained an appreciation for the presence that VR can provide and the impact and impression that it leaves when you have one of these experiences. But we didn't want access to the experience to be limited by the VR headset or hardware that was required. So equipped with kind of this new language and deep knowledge and deep understanding of 360 video medium, for example, we traveled to Santa Fe, New Mexico, and visited Georgia O'Keeffe's home, studio, and natural environments that inspired her work. While we used 360 video to capture those moments and those spaces and locations, and document and preserve those things that we saw, the media was actually then transformed into a very accessible projection-based experience that fully surrounded the audience. And this allowed visitors to appreciate O'Keeffe's work in direct context to her life and surroundings. We still felt this experience qualified as immersive, even though it was not true virtual reality. And so by learning about these tools that are used in the development of immersive tech and immersive media experiences, we start to push beyond the confines of the hardware and confines of even the software and the mechanics of what the VR headset or virtual reality was created for. We start to push those boundaries as aggressively as we can. So we start looking for some of the best explorations into immersion and experience design, which ultimately helped drive kind of the next creative pursuits. If anybody has heard of Meow Wolf, yeah, very strange term, I'll say it again, Meow Wolf, because it took me several times to process that. It is literally an indescribable phenomenon, referenced simply as an immersive art experience, but it is way, way, way more than that. It's really an amazing collection of talent, technology, design and art in a giant tactile playground in a big warehouse that's popping up across the country in different locations. Absolutely a must-see, but really exemplifies this notion of immersive art experience. We tried out various high-end stereoscopic projection-based documentary installations like the one pictured here at the National Geographic Museum in DC. Extremely high-end installation, but also very reliant on specialized hardware and limited in space. Team Lab out of Tokyo develops immersive projection-based experiences and interactive art installations. I haven't been, it's absolutely on my wish list, but they're able to leverage big open spaces to explore new ways of projection mapping and immersive interactive displays that accommodates a large number of visitors simultaneously. A projection or display is not just informational. It becomes transformative when integrated into a space and approached as a vehicle for art and creative expression. So immersive media tools are quickly evolving, as I mentioned, and in many respects already exist in our own homes and schools. We want to push this exploration of these creation tools to demonstrate the process in art form, but also present it as a performance and exhibit piece. Today we'll see the use of a technology called tilt brush. That was playing there, sorry about that. A virtual reality tool suite that allows for digital art creation from within a virtual environment. Tilt brush takes full advantage of a high-end mobile VR headset, which you'll see demonstrated in a bit. We're using a headset called the Oculus Quest, which has two controllers used as the brushes in this environment, as well as the VR headset that places the artist in the digital creation environment. The headset's very advanced. It contains optical sensors that constantly track positions of the controllers or your hands in relation to the controllers in the and yourself in the real world environment. Tools like Tiltbrush helped us get to the next stage of our journey in working with the town of Cary on a dynamic digital mural installation for the GLOW project. Rhett Hissam was able to realize her vision through the use of Tiltbrush by creating a series of nature-based digital murals which were then projected on the side of a building in downtown Cary. The project was very well received, but very few people got to see the process behind the effort. So today, we'll get to see some of that process unfold as Rhett demonstrates the use of Tiltbrush in the creation of a unique digital work of art. I'll briefly introduce Rhett, and then we'll have a short chat on stage here before we drop into VR. So I'll just read this for you. Rhett Hissam is a storyteller and visual artist native to North Carolina. Her work across media aims to reignite the connection between human and nature. In the current age of information overload, Rhett strives to create meaningful art that reflects the truth and importance of our physical environment in the emerging virtual landscape. Please welcome Rhett Hissam.
Okay, let that flick play. This thing on. Hey, everybody. Oh, thank you all for coming today. He's going to steal my notes.
Oh, no. Did you really need those?
I hope
not.
No.
I hope not. No, you're not allowed to have notes. I get notes. Awesome. So, you know, I showed some of the work that you've done and some of the crazy adventures that we've had in the past just very short time. Just to start off, what interested you in, I guess if you call it the field of new media or immersive technology in general?
Yeah. So to start, I mean, my personal background up until I got entangled with Mike was all traditional media, mainly like fine arts background. I was like really turned off by computer art, like didn't get it. Sitting in front of a screen just like was not attractive to me at all. But then I took a VR studio my senior year, graduated from NC State for art and design. And Mike came to speak from Delta. Pat Fitzgerald was the studio professor for that, and actually was Mike's teacher back in the day. So it's kind of a fun legacy there.
Not that far back in the day, but yes.
Not that far back in the day. But yeah, hearing him talk and hearing his colleague Rich, who was also there, talk and show 360 video, like really did it for me. The power of like being able to step into another place in time and to like step into another person's shoes, that like really unlocked something super interesting for me.
So you hadn't done or produced any kind of immersive tech prior to that?
I had done like one video project. Interesting. But at the time I was kind of working in sculpture. I'd gone from doing like mainly fine arts drawing to then working in sculpture and more three-dimensional stuff from my instructor that I'm so glad that is here today. Dana Raymond was a huge inspiration for that. So really, like, I owe a lot of my interest in the 3D space to that time working with, like, physical 3D sculptures. And that kind of really helped me develop that 3D spatial thinking before I stepped into digital stuff.
You definitely seemed interested but hesitant.
Yeah. Yeah, I really was. And I still am today, you know. But I think we'll talk about that later.
Definitely, definitely. We can come back to some of that. So what was your, what did you first start creating in VR? What was your first kind of experience jumping into it?
It definitely changed my way of creating in a good bit. Creating in VR, it's, you know, it moves your spatial, it's like full 360 space that you're creating in. So it frees your mind in that kind of sense. I like the analogy of like sitting in front of a blank canvas, a blank white square, versus like standing in a dark room. Like which one's more inspiring to you? Like to me, standing in a dark room does that for me. Like visually really helps. And it's very much as if you're stepping into like the imaginary plane, like really stepping inside of your own mind in a lot of ways. So I think the first thing I drew was just like this weird, swirly, psychedelic spirit face thing.
This was in Tilt Brush.
This was in Tilt Brush. Was the first one that I guess got started in. So yeah, Tilt Brush is like the iPaint of VR. If anybody remembers iPaint when that got started, it's made to be user friendly. It's made by Google. It's made to like large audience pick it up and kind of be able to learn the tools. So yeah, it's a really powerful tool. It's now become open source. They've like stopped development on it, but it's open source, and the community, like the global community that has been using it, has continued to develop it. And there's like an open project called Open Brush now, and you can like edit it, make your own shaders, and if you're into the more development side, it's become like more customizable, which is really new to see, new and exciting to see. That happened like just past few months. So
what about what traditional artistic skills did you feel like you could really bring to this very digital environment?
Yeah, so I feel like I'm not a 3D modeler. Like I would not claim that title yet, working on it. But this medium specifically really like is somewhere in between sculpting and drawing. Like drawing in 3D space, so it's not one or the other, but I think those are sort of the two skills that lend into this platform for me, is my just background in drawing and in sculpture. But it really creates like this unique style and like unique creation process that the best way I can say is somewhere in between drawing and sculpting. Yeah.
What about the tool as it exists, how did that affect your process?
Yeah, there's a lot of pros to creating in VR. So like rapid prototyping, it's really easy to just get something out really quickly. Being able to switch from materials like just by the click of a button rather than having to go and set up your whole new, like your watercolor paints and then your acrylic paints. So that freedom is really, like, does something for sure, but it also can be kind of crippling, you know? You're kind of like, I can do anything in the world. I think that's what a lot of people struggle with when they get into Tilt Brush. They're like, I don't know what to make.
And
then they just,
that.
Like, draw their name. Yeah.
I literally did that yesterday.
Yeah.
I haven't been in here a while. What about storytelling? Where does storytelling come to play as you step into this environment?
Yeah, so the video portion of it, I would say, like when you introduce time and like kind of get into that like fourth dimension there, animation was never something I really saw myself doing, but creating these works that are 3D, the best way to showcase that is through video if somebody can't put on a headset to watch it. So yeah, there's a lot of that came with it afterwards that I wasn't kind of expecting to step into.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
What are the downsides, right? So, you know, my mom says, don't get that close to a screen, and now I've got screens literally half a millimeter from my eyeballs. So what are the downsides of the medium?
Downsides of the medium as it stands, I mean, the industry is still growing, the audience being, and like the market being a big thing. So like not everybody has a headset in their home. So viewing the art, the platform that it lands on is like, digital artists don't really have a place to put that to be recognized right now. That's one, accessibility just generally to the medium. And like the constant new updates can be a good thing because it's exciting, but there's no like set pipelines. Like there is no like Microsoft and Apple, like Oculus is kind of dominating the market right now. But as far as like pipelines to export this media and then get it into a platform, like it's all like really still mushy right now. And every new media artist that I've met and talked with has their own process, depending on what programs they use, what hardware they use. And so it can be a good thing or a bad thing. For for people that are coming into it and don't have a lot of tech knowledge, like in general, like it can seem very daunting because there's no like clear pathway. So I think that's the challenge of being an artist in this sort of field.
Absolutely. And I remember you starting out where you were looking for instruction. You were looking for how to others on how to do this. And I remember you having a very hard time finding like the three other well-known artists in the world who are quote-unquote multi-dimensional artists, digital artists. I think that's one of the terms.
There's very few resources right as it stands. Only a few artists that I've been able to find that kind of have made tutorials and stuff. There's like release notes for every update, but that's, it's getting better. I think it's about time I start making some tutorials, I think.
Absolutely, and it would help me for sure. Did you ever see yourself becoming a digital artist or animator? Is that what you were aspiring to? Like, where did you see yourself going?
Yeah, it's funny. If you had told me like pre-COVID, before, I graduated college in 2019. Luckily, I got through it before COVID hit. But if you had told me then and there that I would be like a digital artist, fast forward, working in VR, I'd be like, who are you talking about? I don't know who that person is. So I feel really grateful to have been thrown into this medium now, especially post-COVID. But I would have never expected that for myself, mainly because I like to be outside. Like, I like working with my hands. I like nature and this environment and like this world. I don't feel the need to like escape to technology. And I think a lot of the times that's sort of the thought behind it, is like this entertainment escape. But I've been able to kind of find my own little niche here where I'm bringing a lot of what I do is more realism right now as far as like plant-based models and things. So,
awesome. And besides Tiltbrush, you mentioned Tiltbrush, we've seen examples here. What are some of the other tools that are, at least that you're aware of, or up and coming, or things that people might
There's a number of other tools out there, and I like talking about them because, like, as far as designers, like industrial design, if you're more illustrative based, if you're more sculpting based, like there's a program out there that you might like a little bit better. Gravity Sketch is next on my list to really dig into, made for industrial designers, like clean prototyping, clean models. A lot of shoe designers really like that software. So that one's really good for like precision modeling if you're in more of like a serious 3D modeling space. Quill is one of the first ones that really, actually before Tiltbrush came out, a lot of more like concept artists, illustrators, and traditional like 2D animators really gravitate towards that software. It has like a keyframe animation feature, which is Tiltbrush does not have. That's one. Masterpiece VR is another one that's pretty popular. That's got full sculpting, so like clay sculpting in VR, which is really neat. And you can also paint directly on it. And they've just released a whole animation studio as well to pair with that.
So it does sound like there's a lot of tools emerging or evolving, maybe even maturing a bit. What's missing from some of those tools?
Yeah, some of the features that a lot of apps have kind of talked about and hasn't really quite happened yet, like multiplayer being one of them. I mean, how cool would it be if we could be across like two people working, like game designers, for example. I know a lot of game designers live globally, work remotely, and like have to wake up at 3 a.m. or whatever to be in the same room or be on the same conference call. Being able to like show you a 3D model right in front of you and then you add to it and there. So multiplayer, once that gets going in the creation software, I think will be really exciting to see. Multiplayer's one. I don't know. What else do we have?
That's the one I think we've talked most about because I've seen you work, I've seen what you do, but I'm not in the environment with you, which is a whole other dimension, a whole other level. But I think also as motion, the motion tracking, the full body motion tracking gets,
right,
gets more mature, you can start to see the full presence of another person, not just kind of hands.
And I mean, eventually, like with your Georgia O'Keeffe room, like eventually we're not going to need the headset. It can just be a room that we step into, and we'll still be able, you know, to like use our hands. If we, like Fahrenheit 451.
I hope so.
There's a scene. There's a scene in there. It's like that. Yeah.
Awesome.
It's going to get there.
Looking forward to that.
Get there.
Fears. What are the big fears or concerns around VR?
Fears. Yeah. A quote stands out from a professor that I had in college who was like the woodworker craft guy, David Knight. And I transferred from working in that studio and with all physical stuff to all digital. And he said, I fear for the days that we all have blinders on our eyes. And that was like, that really stuck with me, those words. Really, like, we're already kind of stuck like this in front of our phones right now. Like, we're already glued to our little cubes, our little boxes. But I think a lot of, like, general public see VR and see it as, like, a gaming thing. Like, it's like an entertainment and video game thing, which it is very dominated by. The industry is very dominated by that, and I think the audience that and market that uses it right now. But really, like, VR is just a tool, just like anything else. Like anything else, that camera, that piece of paper, pen, like anything we're using to create is a tool. And so I like doing these demos and showing the process behind it, because it's what we do with it that's matter. It's like what content that we're going to make with it is gonna dictate whether it's a good or a bad thing.
Absolutely.
So I think it's really important for content creators to kind of have a bit of a moral sensibility in this field, because it is so impactful. It does have so much impact on like visceral experiences, empathy. People talk about empathy a lot in the VR, creating VR experiences, because it's a story that's meant to just impact like one person, one very personal experience. And when you're really messing with all of the senses, like, you really can have an impactful experience on someone and really, like, change someone's thinking, like, from their own experience. So,
absolutely.
Yeah.
So on that, what do you aspire to create? Where is this going? What's next in terms of content?
That's a great question. Most of my content just comes from my personal experience. And, you know, I was thinking a lot about the term authenticity and, like, what that means to me. And I was kind of trying to, like, broaden it to, like, these larger life statements. But really, like, it's just about your subjective experience, like, doing what means something to you. And what means something to me is, one, Mother Nature, our planet, the Earth that we live on. I think that nature is like divinely intelligent, and if we would just listen a little bit more and like look at it a little bit closer, we could answer a lot of the questions that we probably have. So the perspective of nature and just my experience like as a female, especially working in tech, kind of bringing that feminine experience, that feminine mindset, I think those are what I see is like the most out of balance right now in our world, is like respecting women and feminine energy and also like our environment. So I hope to bring like those concepts into the digital realm, the male dominated, progress oriented digital realm, and just share my experience. Yeah, a lot of it ties back into my personal spirituality and belief system. I don't want to get up here and talk about my spirituality so much, but hopefully that will shine through as well.
Well, the screen that is up right now, you know, I think that was an incredible testament to what you're saying, which this is a shot from what was projected on the building downtown Cary, which Denise from Town of Cary is here, who's an amazing champion for this project. you know, was that meaning, you know, how meaningful was that for you to have that opportunity to?
Yeah, I was reflecting on that project while we were, you know, while we've been preparing for this. And ultimately, like, the GLOW project, the Carrie project that happened back in February was really, like, my dream project. I couldn't have asked for anything better than that a long time ago. Biological illustration was, like, has always been big for me and, like, one of my biggest passions. And it's a way for me to learn about nature and plants is, like, draw it. And yeah, I found, like, some journals back in the day that I was, like, if I could just travel and draw plants for, like, the rest of my life, that would be, I don't think I could imagine a better reality for myself. So being able to, like, all of the plants and species inspired in that piece were all native to this area, and projecting them, like, a lot of people didn't know, like, didn't recognize these plants or had no idea that they were, could grow in your backyard. So yeah, that was a dream experience for me, a dream project for me to, like, make these plants, study them, and then project them in, like, the town center, in this center of a city where people really aren't exposed to that, but, like, they grow everywhere, and they're probably medicinal, and they probably can teach you something.
Fantastic. Yeah. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for what you do, and thank you for taking the time to chat. And let's give Rhett a round of applause, please.
Surprised we got through all that. That was good.
Great job.
Yeah,
all right, good. So now we're going to transition. We're going to get Rhett jacked into VR. That sounded like super hipster. Sorry. There's got to be a better way to say that. So give us a minute as we transition, and yeah, we'll get an interesting demonstration. You're going to talk a little bit
about...
Yeah,
I'm going to talk a little bit about the piece today that we're working on.
I'm going to go.
Yeah, go on. Got it. So we're starting with a 3D model photo scan of myself that Mike and I captured a little while ago. We used photogrammetry to create this model. So if you don't know what that is, it's basically taking a series of photos, like, all around an object and then running it through a program, and it generates a 3D model. When you're capturing something in photogrammetry, like, the ideal subject matter would be something that, like, is motionless and, like, flat color all over it. But I really wanted to capture, like, a human, so I was like, we're just gonna try it, Mike. We'll just do it. So the positioning of the model, like, the pose that was chosen, was actually largely because of the technology that we were using to capture it. Like me sitting cross-legged, like, on the ground, because that was, like, the most motionless that I could be. It was kind of nice. My meditation and yoga training came in a little bit there, like, just really being as still as I could for 5 to 10 minutes. So that's the model that we're starting with today, and I'm just going to be freestyling some light and brush strokes on top of that. The music that I'll be flowing to today is a project by Zachary Sturman, local producer here, called Ancestral Memories, which I thought was a very suiting title to fit along with today. I think that's about it. Are we ready? Okay.
The demonstration should take about, I don't know, 20-ish minutes is what we have planned, but anything can happen. including technical malfunctions are almost guaranteed, but so far everything's been working pretty well.
faster than I meant to on that one. I had to cut it a little short.
I thought that was right.
That was pretty good. Pretty happy with
awesome.
That.
Awesome.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody, for watching. I hope I stayed on screen enough.
Definitely. We're going to break for some questions now. If you all have questions about the process or the tools or anything that you've heard, we'll leave that on screen.
Yeah.
That'll stay on there, right?
Yeah, that'll stay on. So, cursor's in the way, but okay.
I think Marie's working on the lights. But
yeah, lights maybe a little bit.
I mean, I've seen you do that several times now, but every time it's different. Every time it's intriguing. Yeah. Every time it's really just a pleasure to watch the process. So thank you again.
Thanks for sitting here. I meant to say like something in the beginning. If you get bored with me, just tune into the music. Close your eyes for a minute, because Ancestral Memories. Just say that name again. The music that was played today. His description for his audio is paintings for your ears. So I hope that read to you. I love his music. His music was really inspiring as far as like moving to the sounds. So.
And you may have mentioned this before you started, but just what was the inspiration behind Inner Light?
Yeah. So I'm not gonna say this is my aura. I don't know what that looks like. but yeah, I just drawing from some of the colors that I resonate with deeply and pulling out maybe my wings. If I had some, maybe they would look like this. But who's to say? I wouldn't be pretentious enough to say that this is my energy and aura.
That was beautiful. So I bought tickets to a show in Charlotte next month.
The Van Gogh exhibit?
Yeah, having no idea. It just looked cool when it came up on my feed. So is that what this is? But I'm not going to be wearing goggles, right?
Yeah. So it's definitely an immersive exhibit, the Van Gogh exhibit. I'm looking at that, too. I totally want to go. It's in Charlotte right now. I don't know exactly where it is, but it's like full immersive projection room. So I wouldn't say that that's what this is. I don't think it's using the same like process of creation. I don't think it was whatever that they're projecting, I don't think was created in Tilt Brush. I think it was actually his own work that they're projecting. But in the sense of being an immersive gallery exhibit, similar to the Georgia O'Keeffe example that Mike showed, it'll be very similar to that, except way bigger with way more surfaces. And it's on my list to go to. I highly recommend it. Cool.
I do have one more question. So when you were doing everything with your right hand in terms of the drawing and then picking it up on your left, do you have to push a button so that everything you do comes over on both sides? I mean, or can you do things that just happen on one side?
Yeah, you can see there's a mirror tool, that line that's like shooting out of my head right there, kind of moving around. It's a mirror tool, so you can place that wherever. You can turn it off. Doesn't have to be on. But for performances, it looks nice when you're extending it to both sides. So yeah, there's some buttons on the controller, and then there are some like on the palette. So it's a combination of both. And you can switch it if you're left-handed as well.
Hi, I wanted to ask about for your like Town of Cary mural that you did. It looked so intricate and you had so many different flowers in there, and I wondered if you had to draw each of those pieces or if there's a way of like selecting some of your brushstrokes and like copy-pasting.
Yes, copy and paste, some of it. The files, it's something I've been running into with Tilt Brush is because you can like infinitely scale and get really up close and then like make it really big. In 3D modeling, like you can get like way too high of like polygon counts really quick, and then it like slows down the whole file. So that's like an issue I've been running into, because a lot of the detailing that I do is stroke by stroke like on top, but I have like a base model, like I'll create like an asset base model and then duplicate that and then sort of mess it around so that it looks a little more unique and it's not just like repeated. That is part of the process of like breaking down the piece into smaller parts that you can then kind of duplicate from there.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, thank you for sharing your process. It's amazing to see how you work and create these things. It's very physical. I didn't realize it would be so physical. How long do you usually work at once, what I don't know what you call it, sitting or whatnot? Can you work for hours or do you work half hour?
Yeah, so I mean these, so this is the Quest 2. It's, you know, we had it hooked up today so it can be completely wireless. The battery I don't think lasts more than 2 hours. You probably shouldn't be in VR for more than 2 hours straight. You should probably take a break after that. So it depends what I'm working on.
So there is a physical toll that can take on a key or something?
Absolutely. Yeah, after, I mean, this has the elite strap on it, the fancy strap, so that it doesn't give me as much of a headache. But with past versions of the headsets, like I get like a tension kind of from where the band is in the back of my head at about like an hour or two. This headset is way lighter, so it's not as heavy on the head. And I've really enjoyed working with it so far, but the battery will cut out before I'm physically tired now.
One last question. Do you do this at your home, or do you have a studio, or do you go in a special place?
Yeah. It's nice because it's portable, so I could really do it wherever. I've just moved into a new space with, like, a dedicated office space, but even that is like not really big enough to do. Like I had to go commandeer a friend's living room to kind of prepare for today because I didn't have enough space in my apartment to like emulate what being on the stage is like. So when I'm working like this in sort of a more performance type arena, I move differently than when I'm working from home. I'll scale it down much smaller and oftentimes be like in my seat. But it changes what happens when I move and moving with my whole body.
So. Well, thank you again.
Thank you.
I have two questions. One, is that truly three-dimensional? Could you rotate that around an axis and get like a view from the side? Or
yeah.
I mean, so when you're putting that in there, are you're picking the depth plane?
Mm-hmm.
That you're actually putting those images
all parts
in?
Of it. Yeah, I can try. I can put it on a circle, rotate. If you want to see that.
Okay, well, I'll ask my second question. But second question is more: is there? I assume that there's commercial applications other than just the pure art of this, or are there? I mean, so from a viability, is it purely an art medium, or is there applications in industry or just in the commercial world where this would be applied?
Did you mean
advertising, or
do you mean virtual reality itself, or like this specific application?
This specific application, is it gaming, or I mean?
I work at NC State as well, along with Mike and the new media development team. So some of the work and research that I personally have been working on is VR visualization for like audits for education. So like an instructor could take. Like a really complex model, for example, like an engineering model, and like break apart, like have a headset on, be presenting in front of their class or whoever, move around, you know, usually you're looking at like a diagram in a textbook. This way that teacher could like annotate on top of it and draw in space. So there are like some use cases, I think, for like presenting in a more like informational educational context, but yeah, that's a lot of the work I've been doing at the university has been to kind of determine what application works best for what type of content you're trying to use it for.
Are you involved with the new lab that they're putting in at the Craft Center? That I can't remember the name of, but it's something to do with VR. I don't remember.
No.
Nope, don't know about that one. Definitely going to check it out.
There's so many parts of NC State. It's such a huge university. We find out that there's like another VR effort on campus. Right. Sometimes we're like, who are these people? You need to talk to them. Yeah. This kind, like today, this piece that I made today, on paper, felt like nothing when I was trying to sketch it out. So what I said earlier about like being able to step into your imaginary plane like is very real for me in my experience creating here. as far as emotion, there are different times that I step into VR for different reasons. So like sometimes I have an exact plan and it's like this 3D realistic model that I wanted to make. And like that's really just a focus zone that I'm in. So I wouldn't really tie that to much emotion. But I think in this medium, and the parallel that I like the most in between traditional art, my favorite medium in traditional art is black paper with colored pencil on top. So you're drawing, instead of drawing shading in the darkness, you're starting by adding light. And that, with these brushes and this medium, is similar. So that creative process brings about a lot of meaning and richness for me by starting and adding the light and like lighting up darkness. So sort of that metaphor rather than working the opposite way. It means a lot to me.
It's like when you're painting, you might have a very expressive quality to it because of the way you're feeling.
Yeah.
I assume that this might have the same.
Yeah, movement has been like a really big thing for me. Like I'm really passionate about yoga, and I've recently, in the past few years, gotten into ecstatic dance. And that kind of all coincided with the freedom of this medium. So I think that is something that I've brought into creating this way, is like really using my body and movement. And like to prepare for this, I just kind of closed my eyes and wasn't really paying attention to what I was drawing, to the music, and just moving my body to find the strokes that would kind of like naturally occur from that.
Okay. I think that answers my question. And what we're seeing two-dimensionally, you're actually creating it three-dimensionally.
Yes.
Spatially. So where's my headset?
I know, right? I know. That's the next step.
I think the next person who's going to ask a question could answer the technical feasibility of putting everybody in the same VR environment.
Yeah, it's exciting to think about. Photogrammetry, I mean, the process is still, you know a lot about it. You know a lot about it. I'll say it's still kind of difficult because I haven't really done it all by myself. But it's becoming easier and easier. I'm talking about photogrammetry, like the scan of the model that we started with. I mean, eventually you're going to be able to like just do it on your phone real quick. So it's becoming like accessible. So I'm assuming that it's really going to, because it, as it becomes more accessible, will be incorporated in a lot more art just by nature. But I don't really know, I can't really speculate of where to go with it. I think I used to do a lot of mixed media collage type work, like using like photos. So this kind of felt like that to me in a 3D space. It's like starting with a photo scan model instead of a photo. Some like digital photogrammetry collages. Like I don't think that's really been done. Like that could be cool. I don't know. I mean, creative code is just a whole nother ballgame that I am just amazed by the people I've gotten to work with that get into creative coding. I can't even really, it blows my mind. Something I mentioned that I had on here that I didn't get to mention is what's so inspiring about working with other new media artists is like pushing the boundaries. Like, up until I started messing around with like these new experimental features, I was like, you're just copy and pasting. You're just pulling assets off the internet and then like rearranging them. Like, good job. But new media artists like are really doing, like that is the newest technology that is, nobody's seen it before because it's never been done before. And like at one time, the newest color of paint was the newest technology. And the artists that used that and had access to that were like remembered because nobody had ever seen it before. So like new media artists, I think, are doing that, and it's really exciting to be a part of. And creative coding just blows my mind because I am not as much of a science-y person. That's why the tactile bit of it works for me in a way. But creative code, hopefully I'll get there one day. I'll get there one day. Got a few other things to learn first. Thank you.
And in case anybody has questions about photogrammetry or coding, his name is Steven, and I have his work email.
Hi, Rhett. I know that nature is important to you, Mother Nature. I imagine sustainability. What are your thoughts on like tech and sustainability? I know there's a lot of issues with new tools not lasting forever and then ending up as waste. What are your thoughts on that? I don't really have a question. Just
yeah, that's
tell me your thoughts.
It's a wicked question to answer, and I'm glad that you brought it up because it's a very serious concern, you know? If everybody had one of these computers in their home running VR, like we would suck this planet dry pretty quick of energy. So that is like a really big consideration. But also on the other hand, think about all of the throwaway mediums, you know, all of the waste that I used to create as an artist. Like it's hard to really calculate and offset that. And I think environmentally, we all do things in our own life. And, you know, we all have our own footprints and we do what we can in the areas that we can. As for like technology waste, I wish I had a better answer for that. Some of the things that efforts that Mike has done with through state and through the state of North Carolina is like, you know, we bought X amount of headsets for NC State to use in classrooms, and then those became obsolete. And so, like Mike, you set it up for, what was it, K-12? Like, so recycling that old technology for like younger kids and for like small, like different use cases. And like, I think, you know, that's at least we're trying there.
Right, right. It's a scary prospect because of the rate of how fast the technology is evolving. We're creating tremendous waste when something comes obsolete in 3 months. It's mind blowing.
Yeah.
But I think that's where it's really part of the community's responsibility to push manufacturers, to push developers, to push programs and institutions for different ways to reuse and different ways to continue use. Like pulling headsets that are discontinued in a year. Funnel those into other programs that can continue use or open source platforms that are no longer considered viable or valuable to XYZ entity or corporate entity. If now open source, it could really benefit a very broad community. So it's a challenge. But if you look at where headsets were back in 1960-something or 70-something, 68, I think, it took up an entire room of computers and metal and transistors and circuits and this giant thing hanging over somebody's head down to, you know, something even smaller than this X number of years from now could potentially replace the laptop and the workstation and you know, large computer systems. So, you know, I'm hopeful that will continue to evolve, but with a sustainable and reusable mindset.
Thank you. I have another question. I know music is important to you, and do you enjoy the performance aspect of this, and do you have plans to maybe continue to work with live music? I'm bringing your digital media in. I've seen a few things. I like it. Do you have plans to continue?
Yeah, I love music a lot. Music is a big part of my life. And I don't know, I think this is going to be the last one for a little while. I think I'm at a point now where, I've kind of gained like this new platform and I feel comfortable kind of mastering that medium now. But like my art style isn't exactly where I want it to be. Like, and so this next period of time, I think I'm really going to just be committed to honing in on like that art style, because it changed when I moved across medium a little bit, just by nature. So who knows? Maybe not live for a little while, but I don't know. Whatever comes up, we'll see. Depends. Thank you guys so much.
Awesome.
I think I might be out of time.